Mr. Tarrou, in this video, we are going to be taking a look at three examples where we get introduced to how to find a derivative of two functions being multiplied together, the product rule for taking derivatives. We have three examples in the description below. You'll find timestamps to jump ahead to any one of these three examples we're going to be doing. You'll also find a link to the homepage of my channel where you can find any one of the 700 plus math videos I've made from Algebra 1 to Calc 2 and statistics. Our first example here, where we have f of x is equal to h of x. Let's try that again. Our first example here, where we have h of x is equal to x plus 2 times 3x squared minus 1. Well, this is a multiplication of two functions. We have f of x, which is equal to x plus 2, and g of x, you could argue, is 3x squared minus 1. And I'm pointing to this first example before going over the product rule for taking derivatives because we have done problems like this already. We can multiply these two binomials together, write this as an expanded polynomial, and take its derivative simply using the power rule. Just because we're seeing new concepts and new problems doesn't mean we can't still go back and use our old skills that we just learned and we continue to develop. But what if it was an example like we have over here, f of t is equal to sine of t times cosine of t? You need to know the product rule to be able to do our second and final, our third example. So we have here the derivative with respect to x of f of x times g of x is equal to f of x, or the first factor in this expression for which we're taking a derivative of, f of x times g prime of x, indicating with that prime symbol, of course, that we have taken the derivative of g with respect to x. So we have f of x times g prime of x plus f prime of x times g of x. And you might see this in a slightly different order in your book because addition and multiplication are both commutative. But basically what we're doing, when we go to take a derivative of two functions being multiplied together, we take the derivative of the second function, keep the first function the same, multiply those together, and add that with the derivative of the first function times the second. And again, one more time, we haven't reached the chain rule yet. We're not doing implicit differentiation. We're not doing related rates. Our independent variable of our functions, both functions, will need to be the same as the variable with which we're taking a derivative with respect to. So we have that derivative with respect to x, and our functions have the same independent variable, whether that's an x or a theta or a t like we have over here. So again, we could multiply these two binomials together and find the derivative that we are about to find just using power rule that we learned in the previous section. But to build the skills up so we can do example 2 and 3 and other more complicated questions, we're going to go ahead and leave this as f of x times g of x, f of x being x plus 2 and g of x being 3x squared minus 1. And we're going to write in the same color, where's my yellow at? h prime of x is equal to the first factor, or the first function, x plus 2 times the derivative with respect to x of the second function, 3x squared minus 1. And with a lot of practice, you may very well not need to write this step where I'm just simply showing that I'm about to take a derivative. That is going to be plus first factor times the derivative of the second factor or function plus the derivative of the first function or factor, derivative with respect to x of x plus 2 times our second factor of 3x squared minus 1. So we have the derivative of 3x squared, where we're going to bring that power down of 2, multiply it to 3, and we're going to reduce that power by 1. So we're going to have our first factor coming down, I guess I got ahead of myself there a little bit, the x plus 2 coming down, times 3 times 2 is going to be 6. We're going to reduce that fact, that exponent, that power of 2, we're going to reduce that by 1 and write 6x to the first. And the derivative of negative 1, that's a constant. Think of like a line, horizontal line, y equals negative 1. That slope is 0. So we just have, as a result, a derivative of 6x from taking the derivative of 3x squared minus 1. In our second term here, which is a combination of two factors, we have the derivative with respect to x of x plus 2. Well, the derivative with respect to x of x is going to be dx over dx, which you can think of as a division of 1. You can see that x one more time is y equals x. I say it one more time, assuming you're watching more than just this video. I've said this in the last few. Y equals mx plus b, y equals x. That's a line with a slope of 1. There's another way of knowing that the derivative of x is equal to 1. Or you bring the power of the x down, which the degree or power is 1, you bring that power down, you reduce the power on the x by 1, and so you have 1 times x to the 0, but anything to the 0 power is equal to 1. So the derivative of x with respect to x is 1 times, and the derivative of 2 is equal to 0, so we just have the 1 times 3x squared minus 1. We're going to distribute that 1, which isn't really going to do anything because we're multiplying by 1 as a multiplicative identity. We're going to do 6x times x and 6x times 2. So we're looking at 6x squared plus 12x plus 3x squared. Combine like terms, and we have h prime of x is equal to 9x squared plus 12x. So this quadratic equation is giving us the slope of what would be, had been a cubic polynomial if we had expanded those two factors together. So our derivative again gives us the slope of the original function from which it was derived at any point that the derivative exists. Don't forget, we can't take derivatives at the end points of closed intervals, at sharp bends, where the function goes vertical, maybe for just a split second. Any kind of discontinuity, whether it's removable discontinuity or jump discontinuity, but that is the derivative. H prime is equal to 9x squared plus 12x. Our second example has us looking at f of t is equal to sine of t times cosine of t, a product of function f, or, you know, whatever you want to call it. Our first function is sine, our second function is cosine. So f prime of t is going to be a multiplication of two functions, so it's going to be the first function times the derivative of the second function. Sine of t times the derivative with respect to t, not x, of the cosine of t plus the derivative of the first factor or function, derivative with respect to t of sine of t times cosine of t. We just learned these derivatives right in the previous section. We have f prime of t is equal to sine times the derivative of cosine. The derivative with respect to t of cosine of t is going to be negative sine t. So we have the sine of t times negative sine of t, should have moved the work a little bit farther over to the left, plus the derivative of sine of t with respect to t is going to be cosine of t, and then we have that other cosine of t, that factor that we're bringing down. That's going to give us negative sine squared of t plus cosine squared of t. And I'm going to change the order around this here a little bit, giving us cosine squared of t minus sine squared of t. And remember that that notation means that is the cosine of angle t, get that result, and then all of that is being squared. So it's cosine of t and then the power of 2, if you will, on that upper right-hand corner of parentheses. But this is how we write that, those squared functions in trig. You may be looking at cosine squared minus sine squared t and jumping to the conclusion, which will be incorrect, that this is equal to 1, because you're thinking of that Pythagorean identity, which is sine squared theta plus cosine squared theta is equal to 1. This is an identity that you learned in trig, but it's not 1, it's not negative 1. This is a double angle identity. Cosine squared of an angle minus sine squared of that same angle is equal to the cosine of twice that angle, and that is the simplest form that we're going to have for f prime of t, the derivative of t. Our third example coming up right now. For our last example, example number three, we have something that AP likes to do a lot. Why? Because you really have to show that A, you know the derivative formula for when you have a multiplication of two functions. It also makes sure that you actually understand what derivative gives you, which is, remember the definition of a derivative and that long limit process? It was based off the slope formula. Derivatives are functions which give you slope of another function, the function from which it was derived. So we have p of x is equal to f of x times g of x. Using that information along with this graph, not knowing the equations, and please do not try, like I've had some of my students in the past, come up with the equations like they've looked at the graphs and then all the work to come up with a function that models the graphs given, and then they go through the derivative process. It shows a lot of understanding of algebra and graphs and pulling functions out of them, but not quite the point of the problem. What is the derivative of p at the x value of 8? Okay, so first basically just write the formula out. If p of x is equal to f of x times g of x, then p prime of x is equal to the first function times the derivative of the second function, and I'm laughing because the equation's right here. You would not, of course, be given that on a test, but I'm just basically writing the formula out. So the first times the derivative of the second, plus the second times the derivative of the first, so plus f prime of x times g of x. Then to find p prime, or the derivative of p, at 8, that's going to be f of 8 times g prime of 8 plus f prime of 8 times g of 8. And what are we going to learn as, you know, those that are administering the test to you? Do you understand what this prime symbol means? Do you understand that it means slope? And what's the difference of g prime of 8 and g of 8? I mean, that's a pretty important concept if we're just starting to learn, you know, about derivatives and trying to get down to the fact that they're just functions that tell us slope of another function. So what is f of 8? F of 8 is the y value that you get from function f when you plug in an x value of 8. So coming over here to where x is equal to 8, and I've done a pretty terrible job of labeling my x-axis. And y for that matter. So we go over here to 8, we go up to function f, which I drew as the orange graph. So go over to 8, up to the graph, back over, and 4, 5, 6. F of 8 is 6. What is g prime of 8? What is the slope of function g when you're at 8? And the answer that you give to all four of these parts are specific to that location along the x-axis, that location where x is equal to 8. The slope of these functions and the values of these functions are not constant throughout their entire domain. Just a little bit of a footnote there. So g prime of 8, the slope of function g at 8. So coming over here to 8, to the left around that neighborhood, to the left and right of 8, for a small neighborhood, we have a constant slope. And we see that, say, looking at that graph paper, if I go down 1 and over 2, I hit the graph of g again, which is the green one. Yes, double checking. So we're looking at negative 1/2 plus, now f prime of 8. What is f prime? What is the slope of the function f, specifically when you're at or just immediately around 8? Derivatives are instantaneous rate of change, so it's really specifically just at 8, but we're trying to, I'm trying to pull the information out of this graph. So when I go to 8, f of x is not a curve here, it's a line segment, so I can kind of go a little left and right and say to get from 8, 6 to 9, 8, so I have to go up 2 and over 1, just identifying some clear points that the graph goes through on the graph paper. So the slope of f at 8 looks to be 2, and g of 8, g being the green function, g of 8, go over to 8, go up to the function, come over, g of 8 is equal to 2. So our final answer, 6 times negative 1/2 is negative 3, plus 4 is equal to 1. So we have P prime of 8 is equal to 1. That is my third and last example. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go to your homework.